So I would like to welcome you all to the third CERC seminar of the semester. And before I introduce the speaker, I will just indicate that there will be information about our coming CERC talks online very soon if they've not already been posted. So please check our website. We do have another talk coming up soon, also on a Monday, as usual, 4 p.m. But without further ado, I'd like to introduce the speaker and maybe start with an apology. Apologies for the very rainy Hong Kong weather. Our speaker, Dr. Prajak Konkirati, is, as most of you know, from Thailand, and Thailand is lucky enough not to be plagued by such typhoons. Has other issues, flooding, for example, but not such typhoons as we've had. This is our second one of this season. It's unfortunate that we are online, but thanks to our practice from the COVID period, we've all gotten used to this. And we do also have the benefit, of course, of doing this online, getting the recording, which will be available on our website soon. But in any case, welcome to everybody for this online session. Dr. Prajak is a old friend, well, still relatively young, but old friend of the center, has been working with me and others in the center for some years now, has been at the center previously. We're trying to figure out exactly when, but the pre-COVID era, perhaps about 5, 6 years ago for a talk. He is, for those of you who follow Thai politics, one of the most sought-after experts on Thai politics, working at the prestigious Thammasat University. His expertise on current politics, but also with the kind of background he provides, makes him one of the major scholars in the field. Give you some more specifics, he's an associate professor and a former associate dean for research and academic services, as well as former head of the government department at the Faculty of Political Science, I should add the oldest faculty, at the well-known Thammasat University. He was formerly head of the Southeast Asia Studies Center, the East Asian Institute at the same university. He was also a visiting fellow at the ICIAS Yusof Ishak Institute in Singapore. As mentioned, he's published widely in the field of Thai politics, but also in terms of political conflict, violence, party and electoral politics, democratization and social movements. And among his most recent publications are Thailand's failed 2014 election, that was in the Journal of Contemporary Asia in 2016, the Prayut regime, which was published in Trans in 2018, his paper on From Illiberal Democracy to Military Authoritarianism in the Annals of the American Academy of Political and Social Science, 2019, a piece, an overview of the political earthquakes in Thailand, Contemporary Southeast Asia, 2019, often cited article, I should add, Two Mainland Southeast Asian Militaries and Comparative Perspectives, co-authored piece published in 2020, and an award-winning book by the National Research Council of Thailand, When We Vote, Dynamics of Electoral Politics and Democracy in ASEAN Matichon 2019. So Dr. Prajak is obviously talking about a very important and relevant topic, which we're all very much looking forward to. You. Thank you again, Prajak, for coming. Apologies for the weather, and we look forward to your talk.
Thank you, Mark, for a very kind introduction. Despite of the bad weather, I'm very happy to be here, and thank you, Professor Mark Thompson, and also the Southeast Asia Research Center of the CTU, for inviting me and having me here. Next time, hope I can deliver a talk in person in the room. As Mark mentioned, I was an old friend of the center. I published one manuscript with the Southeast Asia Research Center, if anyone interested. Okay, so today As the title of my talk reflects, I will talk about the current situation in Thailand. For those of you who might, you know, have followed Thai political news, there's a lot of confusion related to the aftermath of the election that happened in May this year. The post-election time is quite, you know, volatile and changing very rapidly. By the time now that we have the new government, I would say Thailand already entered a new political landscape. It is a new landscape that very, very interesting, and I hope we can have a fruitful discussion after I finish my talk. What does it mean for Thailand now with the current ruling coalition? So start with the backdrop of the 14 May 2023 election first. So it happened under the circumstance that the former Prime Minister General Prayut Chan Ocha, who was a coup leader in 2014, and after he staged a coup, he stayed in power for, you know, the first 5 years without election. Then he hold election in 2019, manipulate the election successfully, so he returned to power after the 2019 election and served the full 4 year terms as elected prime minister. So in total, he was in power for 9 years since 2014. This is significant because it make him the longest serving prime minister since 1973. Normally, you know, the Thai government and the Thai prime minister, they was out of power for a very short period of time because of political instability. Okay, but prior to the election, the popularity of Prayut and his administration is going down rapidly because of the failure of his administration in, you know, managing the economy, especially after the post-pandemic era. Another important development that I would like to note is the political split between Prayut and General Prayut Chan Ocha. Both of them are the coup leaders. Mm-hmm. And this split weakened the military administration. Okay, I will give more details about this political conflict between General Prayut and Prayut. So look at the key parties briefly in the election. So at the beginning is a contestation between two camps. The opposition parties led by Phuea Thai Party of former Prime Minister Thaksin Shinawatra and the Move Forward Party led by Mr. Pitha Lim Charon Rat is a young, vibrant, progressive party just formed 5 years ago. Okay, the ruling coalition party led by these four parties, Palang Pracharat, United Thai Nation Party or the UTN, Phum Jai Thai and Democrat. Okay, before the voting day, most analysts expect the opposition parties to win this election because they gained the popularity after the COVID-19. So this is a picture of two former coup leaders. On the right side is Prayut Chan Ocha, right, the prime minister before the election. On the left side is Prayut's comrade. His name is General Prawit Wong Suwan. He was called by Thai media a big brother because he's more senior than Prayut, very powerful, you know, well connected, but at the same time tainted with the corrupt, many corruption scandals. So it's not popular among the Thai voters at all, especially the young generation and the urban voters. So this is the result of the election. So the fact that the opposition parties win this election is not a surprise at all. As I told you, before the election, most of the analysis expect opposition to win. But what is the surprise is that the winning party is the Move Forward Party, not the Pheu Thai Party. So before the election, between these two opposition parties, most of Thai academics and experts expect Pheu Thai to win. Pheu Thai themselves believe that they're gonna win landslide in this election because of the strong vote base, because of, you know, the credit that they had in the past when they were in power. And the Move Forward is quite a young party, still lack of experience, and very, I mean, some people say too progressive for Thai political context. And also the electoral system that enforced in this election give a huge favor to Pheu Thai Party. I will talk slightly about the electoral system later. The mixed member, you know, system with the two ballot used to help Pheu Thai win landslide every time when Thailand used this electoral system. This electoral system will be, you know, it not in favor of the Move Forward Party, okay? But turn out the Move Forward Party, you know, win this election with 151 seats. Pheu Thai came second with, you know, 141 seats. Phum Chai Thai, the, you know, the strong patronage type party, came the third. Plang Pracharat and United Thai Nation, led by those two military generals, you know, performed poorly. You can see they got only 40 seats and 36 seats. Okay. Democrat, the old conservative party, one of the oldest political party in Thailand, lost badly in this election, okay, with only 25 seats. This electoral result already demonstrate the new political landscape in Thailand. Now we no longer a two-party system that witnessed during 2001 to 2014. During those time, if you familiar with Thai politics, we very polarized. We have the red shirt and yellow shirt conflict on the street. On the ballot box, we have only two major parties competing with each other. One is Thai Rak Thai of Thaksin Shinawat. When it was dissolved, it changed the name to Plang Prachachon and Pheu Thai. Okay, so that's one camp. Another camp is the Democrat Party. So only these two parties, you know, that compete in the election. Okay, other parties are very small scale and not, you know, play significant role at all. But with this election, you can see from the table that I just show you, we have six parties, you know, that are the major contenders. So Thailand now enter the multi-party system. Another interesting development is we have a wide range of ideology, okay, from the, you know, quite progressive left party like Move Forward to a very ultra-right, ultra-conservative party like the UTN party of Prayut Chan Ocha. เพื่อไทย lost election for the first time since 2001. Actually, since they found the party, they never lost election. They are political giant in Thai electoral politics. Okay, and every time they win election, they win in a landslide fashion. So this is the big defeat for เพื่อไทย. And the two pro-military parties also perform poorly, as I mentioned. Compared to previous military-backed parties, this is the worst performance of military-backed parties in the Thai political history. The two, you know, the defeat of both Pheu Thai and pro-military parties will shape the landscape of this election and also the, you know, the way that the government was formed that I will discuss later. Okay, the Move Forward party, which is the winning party, this is a huge change. It's the fact that the party like Move Forward party, very young, very progressive, right, proposed the, you know, policy package of demonopolization of the Thai economy, you know, reform the military, reform the monarchy, you know, a radical decentralization, this kind of platform are very progressive, and they don't involve in the vote buying tactics at all. They, you know, they run a clean campaign. And despite the progressive platform and the clean campaign, but they still, you know, managed to win this election. It shows that Thai society changed a lot already, right? So these are picture of, you know, two military-backed parties. Pheu Thai party still, you know, strong in the northeast, you know, and among the lower class, lower middle class, you know, the working group and the farmers. Okay. The tall guy is the current Thai Prime Minister, Mr. Setha Thavisin. And this lady is Miss Pathong Than Chinawat, daughter of Thaksin Chinawat. This guy at the center is Mr. Pithan Lim Charanrat, the, you know, leader of the Move Forward Party, very popular among the young generation and the urban voters. Okay. If you look at this table, I want to show you the electoral behavior this time. A lot of Thai voters split vote. Okay, we use the mixed member system. We have both the constituency MP and the party list MP. So Thai voters have two ballot to vote for the constituency candidate and the party that they love, you know, in the party list. You look at the Move Forward party, they gained 14 million votes in the party list. The very popular party, right? But when you look at the constituency vote, they receive 9, you know, around 9 million constituency vote. It means there's quite a big gap between the vote that they gain from constituency competition and the party list, right? Many voters who vote for the Move Forward Party vote for the party, but not for the candidate, okay, in the district. เพื่อไทย party, you know, is a party that get roughly the same numbers in terms of party list and constituency vote. For the ภูมิใจไทย and the พลังประชารัฐ, they represent a local patronage party. If you look at the gap, you see they got a lot of constituency vote, but very little in the party list vote. It means the party brand, the party policy, the party ideology is not, you know, popular at all. People just vote because they, you know, they like the local candidate. Okay.And I want to show you this map since 2001. It shows the, you know, political mapping in Thailand in terms of which party control which region. The red color represents the Thaksin's party. The blue color represents the conservativeDemocrat Party. Other colors represent other small size party. From 2001 to 2019 elections, these two decades, you can see that there are two major parties dominating Thai politics. The Pheu Thai is very strong in the north and the northeast, right?The Democrat strong in the south and the eastern region and some province in the west. Okay, things look similar, you know, during these two decades. But this election, it represents a new political geography of Thai electoral politics.Is if you look at the constituency vote, it's more fragmented. No one party dominate the whole region or the whole country. You know, Move Forward win in, you know, several provinces in the north, some in the northeast. They're strong in Bangkok, you know, almost got every seat in Bangkok.And okay, in the eastern region, the industrial zone of the country, they also popular. They cannot penetrate the south yet. Only one province that again MP seat. The southern region is more fragmented now. 4 or 5 parties, you know, win seat in this region.เพื่อไทย still strong in the northeast and the north, but you can see that they lost many provinces to other parties. So Thailand is more fragmented now in terms of electoral politics. And the party, but the party list vote is interesting. It shows another trend. When it comes to the party, there are only two parties that popular among Thai people now.Which is the Move Forward Party, represented by the, you know, orange color, and the Pheu Thai Party. Okay. It means people, you know, want these two parties to govern the country. People, you know, like the policy platform and ideology that advocate by these two parties.Look at the Pheu Thai defeat. I want to show you this figure to show you, you know, how big a decline is for the Pheu Thai. From 2001 to 2011, they win election every time with a landslide. You can see they can form, you know, single party government almost every time.Okay, look at the party list vote. they get around, you know, between 40% to 67%, very popular. This election, they gain only, you know, 29% of the party list vote. And only one 40 MPs, you know, a lot less than they expect. Okay. The Move Forward Party on the opposite, a new young party, but now gain 14 million vote, make them the most popular party in the country right now. If you look at the party list vote, they win in 43 provinces, and the rest, you know, of the country, they come second. It means, you know, they dominate in almost every province in the country in terms of the party popularity. In 21 provinces that they win the party list vote, they don't even have one single, you know, MPs. They win many party list vote in the south. They even win party list vote in several Boss-controlled provinces, you know, like Buriram, Suphanburi, the province that famous for, you know, the Godfather type.
We seem to have lost Dr. Burjak's video. If everyone can just hold on, hopefully he'll come back online soon. Hi, Prajak, you're muted.
Okay.
Okay.
Do you hear me
We,
now?
you yes, you we you cut off when you were talking about Move Forward's rise after we were
Okay.
back to that. Yes, we're on that slide. Yes, here.
Sorry, I think the internet connection here at the hotel is quite weak. Okay. Now, so they're very popular. They win party list vote in, you know, almost every province in Thailand, even the province that, you know, controlled by the political mafia, political dynasty. Okay. It show how popularity of the party is and show how much Thai voters want to change the country, right? On the opposite, you know, you see a huge decline of, you know, the military-backed parties. Thailand is a land of coup, right? We had many coups in the past, and every time we had a coup, the military will, you know, set up a political party, manipulate the election, and then the military party win the election. You know, you can see in the past, right? But this time is different, right? Both military-backed party, they didn't win the election. They came fourth and fifth, right? And look at the vote that they gained, only, you know, 10% in the district, you know, 1% in the party list, very, very little. It showed that, you know, in this election, most of Thai population, you know, use their ballot power to reject the military rule, right? They want to move the country beyond the military control. But if you look closely, there's no unity among the pro-junta parties. There are difference between the PPRP and the UTN. I want to highlight this difference because normally Thai, observers of Thai politics assume that, you know, military Thai party has only one character. But actually, now you can see two distinct character. The PPRP represent a local patronage party, weak party identity, right? But the UTN of Prayut Chan Ocha, it has a weak party organization. It doesn't have a strong, local candidate, strong patronage politics, but they utilize the royalist ideology. They, utilize the ultra-conservative credentials that Prayut had to win vote from the conservative voters. Okay, but all in all, a conflict between these two generals, Prayut and Prawit, plus the failure of Prayut administration, shrinking the support that they gain from the conservative constituency. Professor Mark Thompson mentioned my article, The Prayut Regime Embedded Military and Hierarchical Capitalism in Thailand, that I co-authored with Professor Wirayut Kanchuchat. I want to make argument that for the royal military elite, okay, in this election, they lost badly, right? So for them, the key question is how to maintain the power that they get after the coup in 2014 and how to sustain the so-called Prayut regime, the military, regime that they craft after the coup and last long for 9 years without Prayut, without Prawit, right? So I think this an important point that you need to understand that the royal and military elite, they don't want to, lose power even though they lost the election, okay? So how to maintain the oligarchical regime that not democratic and at the same time, support by the capitalists who gain monopoly control after the coup, okay, that lead to many tactics that they pursue. Okay, and also the role of Thaksin that will play a part that I will talk later. So they use undemocratic institutional design and the politics of co-optation. Okay, even though the military-backed party lost the election, but they still have many so-called, independent organizations like the Election Commission and the Constitutional Court. This organization, controlled by the military elite, it helped military elite, to disqualify Pita, who win the election, and the role of the appointed Senate, controlled by Prayut and Prawit, right? The Senate, according to the current constitution, even though appointed by the coup leaders, but have power to vote for the prime minister alongside with the lower house. So if, any candidate who want to be a prime minister need to get support, from the senators. Finally, the senators, reject Pita, the head of the Move Forward party that win election, and turn to support the candidate from the Pheu Thai instead, Mr. Setha Thavisin. So basically, this is the politics of isolating the Move Forward Party and co-opting Pheu Thai that the elite play. Okay. Thaksin play a very important role in the post-election politics, right? He was exiled after the coup. His sister, you know, was kicked out of the country also. So for him, he wanted to return home and he wanted to clear his name and his family name. He wanted to prove that he innocent, right? So with the desire of Thaksin to return home, you know, plus the, you know, political desire of the royal military elite to sustain their power, finally they join force. And this is a huge shifting alliance that you're witnessing in Thailand, because in the past, you know, we have the polarized conflict between the yellow shirt and red shirt, between Thaksin, pro-Thaksin and anti-Thaksin force, right? These are two former rivals that shaped Thai politics for two decades. Now, these two rivals, they join force and form the coalition government together by alienating the Move Forward Party. Both of them have mutual interest in weakening the Move Forward Party. The Move Forward Party have been perceived by both Thaksin's camp and the royal military elite as a new threat, right? Pheu Thai lost election to Move Forward. They don't want to work with a Move Forward in the government with the Pita as a prime minister. That's going to make them the junior partner. They don't want to be the junior partner. They want to, you know, lead the government by themselves. That's the only way they think they're going to come back as the number one party and win the next election. So Thaksin want to return home. Pheu Thai party want to lead the government. Thaksin know that in order to return to the country, he need, you know, the approval from the palace. The palace saw and the military saw the Move Forward as a formidable threat, because the Move Forward proposed that they're gonna reform the monarchy and the military if they were in power. So finally, both Thaksin and the palace, you know, have the same interest in working together. Prayut and Prawit, these two military leaders, also want to step down from power with impunity, right? And still have some control over Thai politics through their proxy parties. So the only way that military party who lost the election badly to retain certain amount of power is to join coalition government with Pheu Thai. Okay. So that's why you see this strange, you know, partnership between this, you know, military general Prayut and his, you know, former rivals, you know, Pheu Thai's party candidate, Mr. Setha, with the support of the royal family. So the big question that I want to throw here, and we can discuss later, are Thailand moving beyond the color-coded conflict between the yellow shirt and the red shirt that we have seen in the past two decades, right? Some red shirt supporters and the yellow shirt supporters now, they have a meeting together after the election. They're happy that now, you know, their leaders can form, you know, government together. And they said now that now we have a new common enemy, which is the orange color, which is the color of the Move Forward Party. Okay. I would argue that now Thailand has a new political cleavages. In the past, you know, Thai scholars talking about the urban-rural divide, the regionalism, right, as I show you the political mapping, and the cleavages between pro-Thaksin and anti-Thaksin, which is based on, you know, the populism and anti-populism. The cleavages that based on democratic ideas, right? So you have the pro-military and anti-military, you know. But I think in the past 3-4 years, and clearly after this election, you have a new division emerged, which is the generation divide and the royalism, okay, as a new cleavages. I think we cannot separate the youth protest that emerged and last long for 3 years from 2020 to 2023 from this electoral result. Okay. Because the youth protest that, you know, had a radical demands of reforming the monarchy, it chopped the palace and the Thai establishment. Okay. This pro-democracy student protest, which finally, you know, was suppressed violently by the Thai state, okay, they're not happy with, you know, the dissolution of the Future Forward Party, the former party of the Move Forward. They're not happy with the socio-political conditions, you know, rising inequality, very repressive regime after the coup, the, you know, hyper-conservative education and the curriculum in the school that led to the protest of the high school students that we never witnessed since 1973, you know, high school student protest. This is huge, you know, and historic. And the demands of the pro-democracy student movement, which is not only asking for the resign of Prayut and rewriting of the constitution, but reform of the monarchy. This shocked the palace. So now I think with the new cleavages, Thai politics is divided not between pro-Thaksin and anti-Thaksin anymore, not between, you know, the yellow shirt or the red shirt, not between the, you know, north and the northeast and the southern regions. No, it is, I think, the most important divide is between, you know, the people who advocate for the reform of the monarchy and the people who want to protect the status quo. Okay. And we can talk more about the role of the status of the monarchy in Thai politics, which is, I think, the center of gravity of Thai political society. Okay. Now my last slide, okay, and I'm going to end here. So what are the lessons? I call this Thai style hybrid regime, okay. So with this election, we see the entrenched royal military elite power through undemocratic institutional design and the politics of co-optation. They successfully co-opt their former, you know, biggest rival, Thaksin Shinawatra and Phuea Thai, right? It shows that the Thai, you know, royal military elite, they're able to obstruct democratic transition. and they successfully maintain power despite the fact that they lose the election badly. If you know, familiar with the Thai political history, in the past, Thai military set up the political party, but it's not, you know, a strong institution. Even though they managed to win election in the past, but finally there's a internal conflict, and finally that led to the collapse of the military party. And then when they lost power through the electoral contest, they have to stage coup again. Okay, but this time round, I think they find a new solution. Okay, even though military backed parties lost the election, they still have the undemocratic constitution. They have the appointed Senate. They have the constitutional court to help them, you know, disqualifying the opposition parties, opposition politicians. And also they find a way to co-opt, you know, the opposition parties like Pheu Thai to work on their behalf. So in the Thai case, it's still proof one of the, you know, general rules that we familiar with in the comparative politics literature, which is one of the most important factor for democratic transition is the unity of opposition parties. Okay, without that, it's difficult to have a smooth transition to democracy after a long time authoritarian rule. And in Thailand, this is what we lack this time. The Thai military and palace successfully, you know, disunite the Pheu Thai party and the Move Forward party. Okay, that's it for my presentation, and I will be happy for the Q&A session. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prajak, for that comprehensive and very enlightening talk. You've put a lot of the issues that I think many of us have been reading about in a perspective and framed it in such a way that we're likely to be seeing things a bit differently now. So as questions come up, at the moment, I don't see anybody who has raised a question. Kevin from the CERC office can also alert me to questions as they're raised. But let me go ahead and perhaps kick off with two questions. Mm-hmm. The first is, we talked about this earlier, but I think the audience might be interested. You mentioned it in passing about Thaksin's own interests and how they affected this transformation, this seemingly abrupt turnabout. Perhaps you could comment about how Thaksin's interests were served by this compromise with the military. And the second question is to follow up on your last point, which is, in a sense, if I understood you correctly, what you're saying is finally, after being kind of ham-fisted and clumsy and awkward and not very sophisticated in its exercise of power over a series of military regimes over decades, finally we see the military monarchical regime acting in a somewhat more sophisticated fashion with this divide and conquer. And so my question is if this is true, and based on your previous analysis, which basically was about how this kind of hybrid regime is incapable of political sophistication, why that happened? Was it lucky? or has something actually changed in among conservative forces so that they have this more strategic outlook, perhaps you could call it, that has allowed them to solve this current issue in a more in a less blunt manner than previous coups were?
Mm. Thank you, Mark. Very good questions. You always ask tough questions. but okay, Thaksin's role. I think Thaksin played very, very critical roles in this election and the post-election time. So Pure Thai Party, even though it is, the largest party in Thailand in the past two decades, but it's not a democratic organization. It's still basically owned by Thaksin's family. Thaksin is a de facto leader of the party, even he was in exile for several years already, right? So what he want all along is to return to Thailand, okay? And if you remember in the last election, he also tried to make deal with the palace by, set up one sister party of Pheu Thai, and he proposed the very controversial candidate, which is the sister of the king, right, as the prime minister candidate of the party. So if you look back in the past, Thaksin want to make deal with the palace, but so far it was failed. All the deals that he made had failed. This time, he also sent a strong signal since the beginning of the campaign that Pheu Thai will not, change the status quo. Pheu Thai will not, touch upon the reform of the monarchy issue, okay, and the Lese Majeste law, okay. Thaksin, with his ultimate goal of returning home, finally, when the result of the election turned out like this, that the party lost the election to the Move Forward, and he knows that the military and the palace don't want Move Forward party in power. So he see this, space that he can maneuver, right, to convince the royal and military elite to help the Pheu Thai party to form the coalition. So for Thaksin's point of view, is a win-win, right? Because he get to return home after almost, 17 years. His party, in power, right? And for the palace, it's a win-win too, right? They get rid of Move Forward party, and now they have Thaksin under their control, right? They have Thaksin under their, command. So that's the role of Thaksin. I think without Thaksin's ultimate goal of returning home, we might have seen different strategy from Pheu Thai, okay? But that's a big if. Okay. For your second question, I think the conservative elite is not smarter or not more sophisticated, but I think the situation forced them. I think it's important to highlight that the reform of the monarchy, the critical view toward the monarchy that happened in the last 4-5 years is shocking for the Thai elite. It never happened before because it's a taboo in Thailand, right? To talk about the monarchy, the royal family, since the 1950, I would say 1950, 1960s, you have the royal supremacy, you have the royal nationalism as the official Thai state ideology. It's like all the social movement, all the political party, working towards the monarchy and accept this hegemony of the palace. The fact that now you have a young generation, the student protest, and also the new young political party like Move Forward dare to talk about this issue in the parliament, in the election campaign, that was very threatening. So this situation forced the Thai conservative elite to you have to work with Pheu Thai, you have to work with Thaksin if you want to, you know, get rid of this threat. But I think the weakness remain, right? If you look at the military backed party, weak organization, weak support from the Thai population. It means in the next election, they will have to struggle again how to maintain power.
Okay. Thank you, Prajak. There are a couple of questions that have come up. I think you can see them on your screen as well.
Okay.
There is one question here about, we see a period of free speech when the Section 112 was discussed openly. Now that the new government is formed, how is the freedom of speech in Thailand going to be affected? There's a second question about Pheu Thai and Move Forward and whether there was some cooperation during the campaign and perhaps you can discuss the period shortly after where they seem to be cooperating. And the third question is about monarchy reform and whether it's a euphemism for ending it altogether, whether the substance proposals to weaken or reorganize the monarchy's relationship with the state.
Okay, thank you for the questions, all good questions. Okay, let me...
Sorry, Prajak, could you unshare your screen so we can have a bigger view of you?
Sure, sure.
We'd like to have a large version of our speaker.
okay. Let's answer the first question first by Kaya about 112 article, right? The Lese Majeste law or defamation law. It is now you ask about the current situation with the new government. How is the freedom of speech in Thailand? Sadly, the situation is not getting better in terms of the freedom of speech, especially related to the Section 112. Now, even after the election and the new government was formed, there's still many Thai activists, the students, and you know, the pro-democracy activists have been arrested because of some of their comment, some of their Facebook posts, some of their, you know, speaking in the public critical to the monarchy. So the article, the Section 112 is still being used by the police and the people in power, you know, in arresting people, try to silencing the critical voice. There's one protest leader, the prominent Thai human rights lawyer, his name is Anon Nampa, who received the prestigious Gwangju Award from South Korea, right? He led the protest, you know, in 2020, and now he was put in jail because finally the court you know, had a ruling in one of his case related to his speech criticizing the role of the monarchy in politics. Okay, and he was denied bail. Okay, so now he's in jail right now. So the situation is not improve at all in terms of, you know, freedom and civil liberties. Yeah. Okay. So the second question by Joyce about Pheu Thai and Move Forward party relationship. Now, I would say they no longer perceive each other as allies or friends. Now they become enemies now. It's sadly to see this development, right? In the past 4 years, they worked together in the parliament as opposition parties to try to reform Thai politics and democratize Thailand. But now there's a real split between these two parties, because by the fact that Pheu Thai willing to join, you know, force with the royal military elite and now form a coalition government with General Prayut's party, General Prayut's party work with the military, and now they no longer talk about the reform of the army anymore. So it makes supporters of Move Forward parties, you know, feel very uncomfortable with Pheu Thai party. And so now Move Forward party is the leading opposition party, right? So their main job is going to be scrutinize the Pheu Thai party, okay, as a government. So now very competitive. And Pheu Thai knows that now if they want to win election next time and come back is the, you know, number one party as a political giant in Thai politics again, now they have to, you know, compete with Move Forward party. Their number one enemy or competitor is no longer the Democrat party. It's not the Palang Pracharat party of the military. It's the Move Forward party. Okay. Because they, you know, compete and attract vote from the same pool of voters who are, you know, pro-democracy, pro-change in Thailand. Pheu Thai used to be a reformist party, right? And they used to control, you know, and gain all the vote from this constituency, you know, population who fed up with the military control and want to change Thailand. In the past, Pheu Thai has no competitor in this camp, in this same camp. But now with the Move Forward party emergence, Move Forward party, you know, steal a lot of vote from this constituency. So now they become the competitors. Okay. So next question, is monarchy reform merely a euphemism? I don't think it's a, okay, it's difficult to answer this question, because in Thailand, as you know, we don't have freedom to talk about this issue freely and safely, right? For example, you cannot have a referendum on this issue in the same way that, you know, in Britain, you can do a referendum, right, on the monarchy, right? You still want to keep the monarchy, or you want to change to the republic. In Thailand, you cannot discuss this, even in the university. Okay, no safe space. So when the student protest saying that they want the monarchy reform, it can mean differently by different, subgroup within the movement. The most radical group, they might think of something beyond the monarchy reform. They might think of the regime change, right? But we don't know. We don't know exactly what they really think. Okay. But I would say the common ground is they want Thailand to be truly constitutional monarchy, similar to Japan or Britain or European monarch, right? That monarchy is the head of state, is the symbol of the nation, is a moral force, but not intervene in politics, have no role in administration and legislative power. I think it's safe to say that, okay, this is the minimum, this is the common ground that every, pro-democracy activist and protester, want, okay? So next question, Mark, do you want, I saw another question.
Yeah, go ahead, Richard. Feel free.
Okay. Were Thai people happy to accept Pheu Thai Party as the second choice, or there were just no other choice? To what extent do Thai people prefer to clientelist party? Good question. It's a big controversy, right? The way that the Pheu Thai formed the government. Okay. Pheu Thai called their government as a special government. Okay. They said this the government for reconciliation to move beyond the deadly conflict, okay, that Thailand witnessed. So they said we need compromise, we need to work with enemies, we need to work with the military. Okay. But by the fact that they join force with the military, who has a role in suppressing and killing the red shirt people who were the supporters, main supporters of the Pheu Thai themselves, that led to the, heavy criticism among the red shirt supporters. So now many supporters of Pheu Thai are not happy at all, with Pheu Thai compromise, with Pheu Thai join force with the elite. Some supporters are okay, they want Pheu Thai to be in power and implement populist policy, to help them. So you have a real debate among the supporters of Pheu Thai. Yeah. Many supporters, I mean, a big chunk of Pheu Thai supporter now, they abandon the party and they support the Move Forward Party instead. They think Pheu Thai no longer represent them. Pheu Thai no longer represent a pro-democratic force in Thailand. Okay, so they very disappointed. But not all of them abandon the party. You have another chunk of supporters. We don't have statistics yet. We don't have a survey yet how many of supporters, still support the party, how many abandon the party. Yeah, but you have some supporters are okay with this move of the Pheu Thai. They said it's no choice, no other choice. If you want to implement good policy, the populist policy, which some supporters believe that gonna help the poor people, who face the economic hardship, this is the only way to gain power, right? To work with the former rivals. Okay.
Prajak, if I could just, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, sure. Ma.
If I could just follow up on that, I mean, and also on your discussion of the new cleavages, you know, in American politics, they might speak of a realignment, right? That the realignment going on. And in terms of a realignment, the one thing that occurs to me, if you think about the US case, is how, you know, populism has been directed, for example, against urban elites, against intellectuals, the education gap, which of course exists in Thailand even more in a sense than in the US. And I'm wondering, I mean, this is all speculation, obviously, but I'm wondering if you see any tendency, because, you know, rather than talking about democracy, if the focus was on populism helping the poor and so on, one could then point to, you know, the elites and cities and say, you know, there are enemies now, and because that is the base, the future forward, I'm guessing also in the provincial breakdown you showed, future forward is tends to be strongest in the cities. Certainly is very strong in Bangkok, as you said. So do you see any potential of that kind of a realignment involving kind of a, I mean, there already is this rural-urban divide, as you said, in Thailand, but of a different sort that's directed not against the conservative establishment, but now at the at this upstart pro-democracy party.
Yes, I think a big realignment is going on in Thailand. We might need more time to see how and which direction is heading, but I think we start to witness this big realignment. Some former yellow shirt who not I think the most confusing group of people is the former yellow shirt who used to anti-Thaksin and support the royal military elite, right, to fight with Thaksin, because I think Thaksin is the biggest threat. But now, you know, military and palace willing to work with Thaksin, now they're disappointed. But for them, it's still difficult for them to change their stance right now. It's too hard to accept the move forward, to embrace the move forward agenda, because the yellow shirt, deep down, they still, you know, love and respect the monarchy and the conservative values. So the Move Forward Party not truly represent them too. Okay. But now with Thaksin back to power, Pheu Thai back to power with this populism package, the flagship policy is, you know, spend, you know, a lot of money, give 10,000 baht to all Thai people above 16. That's gonna be huge. You know, led to the, you know, some people already calculate 3.6% of the GDP, you know, that's going to be spent by this populist policy of Pheu Thai. Many Thai economists, former yellow shirt, you know, former anti-Thaksin intellectual already came out in public and strongly criticized this policy. Okay. So some supporters of Pheu Thai accuse them of, you know, being anti-populist. And some try to lump together between the Move Forward Party and the Democrat and the Yellow Shirt now that they are in the same camp of anti-Thaksin. If you criticize Thaksin, if you criticize Pheu Thai now, you're going to be labeled as anti-populism, anti-poor people. So some huge realignment is going on. Yeah.
Absolutely fascinating to also be a political scientist, kind of watching as the stream or the river shifts and jumps over its banks and starts a new direction. To use that analogy, it's fascinating, and it's not often in politics that we experience it and experience it in real time like this. It's
Yes.
absolutely fascinating.
Yeah.
And you think of U.S. politics, that's the trends that have been kind of continuing over years and get accelerated. But in Thailand, there's this, because of these strategic interests, a pretty abrupt realignment. Yeah, fascinating. Are there other questions?
I saw two. Right?
Okay, go
Can
ahead.
You,
go ahead.
you
I can't see them on my screen, so go ahead.
Interesting to note the policy stance of the youth movement that is anti-monarchy, anti-conservative education, and inequality. We see the last two of those issues in the various Hong Kong opposition movement. Do you see the latest youth policy goals being similar to those in previous movement like 1973? Is every youth movement just a revival of the same progressive policy goal, or is this one different? Okay, good question from Chris. Yes, when I studied youth movement in Thailand, I compare it to other countries too, and I found very striking similarities, right, between Hong Kong and Thai youth movement. Not all the same, right, but some agendas on conservative education, inequality, right? But you mentioned, okay, 1973 student movement, and you ask, is this different or the same? I would say it's different. Okay, actually, I wrote one paper, but in Thai, on this, comparing student movement in 1973, which is my master thesis based on this topic, and the current youth movement. I mean, on the surface, they look very similar. Pro-democracy, asking for a new constitution, demand the military prime minister to step down from power, you know, reform of the military, but and also the socio-economic issues, you know, the inequality is big for both 1973 and the current youth protest. But one different, and I think very important different, is the stance toward the monarchy. In 1973, the student movement, you know, is a pro-monarchy movement. They support the monarchy. At that time, they even saw monarchy as a better and alternative leader of the Thai politics. They use the royalist symbol, you know, to discredit the military dictatorship. Okay, basically they pit the palace against the military in 1973. But this time the youth movement saw both the military and the palace as political allies, and both of them are the obstacles of democratization in Thailand. I think this is a huge difference. Okay. Okay. Kaya asks another question. May I ask, how is the Thai voters reacting to MFP handling of the situation? I saw there is a criticism of the MFP not being able to do the math and throwing away their wins. Do you think MFP have known all along that they would only get to play along instead of sitting in the government? Do you think the result of how the government is formed at the end has been scripted at the beginning? Okay, good question. I think it has been scripted by Thaksin and the establishment. They want to form government together at the beginning. Everyone know that, right? But the script can be changed, right? It doesn't mean it's set in stone. Especially when the electoral result came out like this, I think เพื่อไทยat the beginning they know that if they win the election actually it's easy for them right, to form coalition with the military, because the Move Forward party gonna be in the opposition if they lost the election, if they came second or came third. But when, you know, Move Forward, you know, win this election, I think it's destroyed the whole plan that already planned by Thaksin and the military. They know that if they try to break, you know, I mean, if they try to form the coalition government between themselves right away, it's gonna look bad. It's gonna lack of legitimacy. So that's why, you know, at the earlier period after the election, you see an attempt between Move Forward Party and Pheu Thai to work together. Okay. I think at that time, okay, there's still a slight chance that Pheu Thai and Move Forward can form government together. Okay. I think Move Forward knows the math, and they know that they need support from the senators, right? To overcome that obstacle. And they think Pheu Thai can help them, okay, to get some support from the Senate. Okay. I don't think Move Forward Party is truly naive. Okay. They know that it's difficult, okay, to get the support from the Senate, to get the support from the military and the palace. Okay. But there's a slight chance that they think if Pheu Thai still stick with them, right, with this 8-party coalition, they have 312 MPs in the House. It means that if Pheu Thai stick with them, the military party cannot form coalition, right? It might take time. You might have to struggle a little bit, but there's still a chance. But finally, I think it's a Pheu Thai who throw that chance away of forming the democratic coalition together. All right.
So okay. Is there one more question there, Prajak?
If so, yes.
That would be the last one, then we'll stop it. Go ahead.
Yes. As a scholar, how do you foresee Thai people keeping the elite power, including the monarchy institution, in check, as a current establishment seem to be favoring all this elite? Okay. Good question. It's a challenging task, right, for the Thai people, but I think I'm more optimistic than being pessimistic. If you look at the youth movement that lasts on for 3 years, right, and hundreds of thousands joining the movement, I would say it's a youth awakening. We haven't seen the student protest and the youth movement for a long time. The last time is 1973 and 76. It's 4 decades already, right, that we haven't seen youth activism. The fact that now we have, you know, the political participation from the youth and the students, you know, it show a good sign, right? It show the new consciousness, political consciousness being formed in Thailand. And also in political party landscape, I see a lot of change. Right. In the past, when you study Thai elections, you know, it's very predictable, right? And for the factors that help one candidate or one party to win, you can name it all, right? Political families, you know, vote buying, clientelistic network. Okay. But this time you see that political party that can win election without all those factors. They don't use the political dynasty. They don't use the vote buying tactics. They don't, you know, employ, you know, coercion or vote brokers, clientelistic network to mobilize vote. They, you know, propose policy platform, you know, policy for change. You know, they stick to the principle. They run a clean campaign and 14 million vote for them. And I think this is a good sign, right? And so, but obstacle remains. I mean, you need to amend this constitution, which is very undemocratic. You need to still, you know, advocate for the reform, okay? But if civil society have a strong linkage to the political party, you can use both the parliament and the, you know, civic space, you know, to advocate for change, I think. Yeah. And that's happening, and it's going to happen in the next 4 years in Thailand before the next election. It will be contentious time for Thai politics, both on the street and, you know, in the parliament.
That's an interesting final note about the fact that we may see more political unrest ahead. So all that remains actually is to say, as many of the others have already done so in the chat, thank you very much for Jock for this very insightful talk. And brought us all up to speed very quickly. And as you can tell by the questions from the audience, there's a lot of interest. And again, our apologies for not having the possibility of doing it in person. But again, thanks for coming. We know you're in Hong Kong, even if we haven't been able to see you personally yet. And I see outside here anyway, the rain is diminishing. So presumably your flight will not be canceled tomorrow. So that's the good sign. Thanks again. And thanks to everyone who participated in this event, and wish us all a good evening. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Mark. Very fruitful and stimulating session. Thank you, everyone.